to me, a watch is all about a disguise. We all wear disguises. It's nothing to be ashamed of. It's part of our disguise, our mask. We all wear masks. Am I right? How long have we been wearing masks, McMahon? How long have we been these phony people? Well, we're not phony. We wear masks. It's how we get along in the world. I mean, Adam and Eve, man, they were expelled from the Garden of Eden. You know what the first thing they did? They grabbed a fig leaf, man. They felt ashamed and they covered themselves with a fig leaf. Now, we don't do that. We don't cover ourselves with fig leaves anymore. We wear a Breitling Super Avenger or a Rolex Deep Sea Dweller or, in my case, an Orient Saturation Diver. It is the modern equivalent of the fig leaf. We have to wear disguises. It's part of life. We wear a mask. We have a certain identity. A watch could be your identity gadget that makes you, you want to be an astronaut or an actor or a nautical assistant, a Jacques Cousteau. You know, I would love to be wearing really nice, beautiful watches and be a TV talk show host. You know, when I was a kid, I used to play baseball with these dice. I made up this game and I would announce the games in a Panasonic tape recorder for like 8 hours a day. And I'd play back the play-by-play and I would even do interviews. I would play like Willie Mays and Bobby Bonds and I'd be the announcer, whoever it was, Hank Renner of the Oakland A's. And of course, I'm not a TV talk show host. No way, buddy. You became some sort of a critical thinking professor. And what I want to talk about today are disguises, the modern day equivalent of the fig leaf worn by the shamed Adam and Eve. We got to wear a disguise. The problem is when you take your disguise too seriously and you don't understand the meaning of your disguise, you don't understand the quality of your disguise. If you are fooled by your own disguise, it can be dangerous, and that's what I want to talk about today. In the context of watches, of course, of course. So check this out, man. I have a buddy. I've known him for like 30 years, and he lives in Laguna Hills, man. No, Laguna Beach. Forgive me, Laguna Beach. And he's a very successful banker, and about 10 years ago, he had about 12 really expensive Swiss luxury watches. And here's what he told me. He said, I'd get up in the morning to go to work and I couldn't decide which watch to wear. And it was taking up all this time, it was driving me mad. And in a state of exasperation, my friend Deep gave away all of his Swiss luxury watches to family and friends. And he's happier. He had to do it. Could I do that? Could I go the rest of my life without wearing a watch? I thought about it, and of course I could, but I would feel undressed. I would feel like Adam and Eve, expelled from Eden without my fig leaf. This is a fig leaf, so to speak, a rather glorified one. Just don't take the fig leaf too seriously. You need to understand the underpinnings of your disguise, and you don't want to take it too seriously. You have to know how it works, though. I like it when people use things, and not only do they use them, but they know how they work. You know what bugs me? A lot of people, they drive cars, and they don't understand their PSI. I go, what's your tire pressure? No, I don't know. You're driving around, and you don't know what your prescribed tire pressure is? You don't know your PSI? I don't think I can be your friend. You're dangerous. No, I'm kidding. So a disguise is part of our identity, but sometimes in life you need to question the disguise and you need to not take it too seriously. I'm going to tell you a cautionary tale. I call it the Dan Beavers story. I was 15 years old. It was 1976 in the summer. Disco was raging and I used to go to a man-made beach by my house. It was called Lake Don Castro. You know, they imported all this sand and they turned the lake into kind of a beach. And there was a grassy knoll. And every day for about a month in the summer of 1976, Dan Beavers would show up. He was in his mid-20s, late 20s. He drove a black Camaro. He had garter belts stacked on his stick shift of his black Camaro. And he would hang out by the grassy knoll above the man-made beach. He had his boom box, he had his Playmate cooler, he had his blue Speedo shorts on, his white puka shells, his gold medallion. And he really had the disguise. He really had his fig leaf going, man. He was the aspiring disco playboy of the 70s. He always had a white frisbee. And every day, man, he was like my role model, man. I'd watch him play frisbee and with the ladies, and I had no social skills, man. I was so awkward socially. I was hopeless. Hopeless, man. I was taking notes, man, from Dan Beavers. And you know what, man? I think Dan Beavers, to meet women, I think he was reading a best-selling book at the time that was translated into dozens and dozens of languages. It was called How to Pick Up Girls. Oh gosh, I can't remember the guy's name who wrote it. It was a horrible book. It glorified being a predator. It pretty much told you, you know, to relentlessly be a predator of women. And it was a bestseller. I only knew about it because I read some of my dad's magazines. He had a certain magazine collection as a young man. I was very curious about these magazines, and in the back there would be a advertisement. Oh great, the gardeners are here. Great! So we'll see if we can continue this video without being lawnmower bombed by my neighbor's gardeners. Trying to maintain professional production qualities, buddy. So yeah, I think I was reading that book because I would read excerpts and advertisements for it in the back of my dad's magazines. And I kind of understood what was going on. There was a certain script. It was really smarmy and sleazy. And I think Dan Beavers was reading How to Pick Up Girls. But one day, Dan Beavers stepped on a bee and he got stung. And I saw his foot turn into this giant club and he was sweating. And the girls that he was playing frisbee with, "Are you okay?" "I'm great. I'm fine." And they kept asking him. He was getting worse, man. His foot was getting worse and worse and bigger, and I thought he was going to die. And he couldn't tell the girls he needed to get medical attention. He kept playing frisbee because his disguise of, you know, the top macho man, he took it so seriously, he couldn't walk off the script. My friend Deep, when his watches were driving him crazy, he had to walk away, man. Dan Beavers couldn't walk away. I don't know what happened to Dan Beavers because me and my bodybuilding buddies, we got distracted by something and I never saw Dan Beavers again. I wonder if he died. I hope he's okay, man. I don't know. But I don't take my watches too seriously. I make fun of myself. If I find my script is dangerous or I'm taking myself too seriously with it, I walk away, man. Sometimes in life, you gotta walk away from the script. As a watch predator, you don't want to drink your Kool-Aid and start believing in it. That's a dangerous situation. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's all I have to say today. And until next time, I'm out.